professional space. We will be discussing topics that cover the daily real estate activities, investing, and how El Paso stacks up against the U.S. markets. My first question today goes to Rick. He lived both in L.A. and New York City. I want to know, how do you feel that a person has to have, do you feel that a person has to have a basic understanding of bigger markets and also understand the U.S. economy to go ahead and do well in investing?
Absolutely, without a doubt, guys. The biggest thing that a realtor, no matter what city they find themselves in, whether it be El Paso or any other city in Texas or any city across this great country, is they have to have a basic foundation and understanding of what's going on in the national economy. So when a little bit before the real estate recession hit, people were invested in buying property left and right. They were buying property at counting foreclosures, and people were getting properties pennies on the dollar. With that said, fast forward to what happened afterwards. Big conglomerate companies, hedge fund companies, private firm companies started buying in on that same idea as well. And as a result, they started taking a lot of mom and pop investors out of the threshold. So what that means is that for a local investor like ourselves or any realtor who's representing an investor, they're not gonna be getting the same type of margins that they used to 10, 15 years ago. There's still gonna be good properties out there, but they're just gonna have to find different avenues as to how to acquire a property that has bigger margins, and bigger margins equals bigger profit. So before, you could find a property pretty simply, just without a doubt, find a property and be able to flip it, make a good amount of rate of return. Now, as a result, you're going to the kind of foreclosures and you're seeing properties that are being put on the foreclosure auction with a higher opening bid. And what that means is that if you're buying a property that's already over leveraged, overpriced, and too many people are touching that property, then you're not gonna have the margins that you're looking for as an investor. And if you're representing an investor and you're a realtor, they're not gonna be as happy because they're gonna be struggling to try to make ends meet on the back end of that property. So absolutely, you have to really get an idea as to what's going on in the national economic cycle so that you're able to inform your buyers in a little bit different perspective.
What are the best ways to flip? Do you recommend using capital and cash to purchase, or do you guys recommend borrowing the money?
Yes, everybody is different. It depends on your financial status. Some may not, and depending on your situation, you don't want to put everything you have into flipping a home. But I think everybody is different, so depending on your financial status.
And you also have to think about you know, all the costs that are associated with. So you're talking about holding costs, closing costs, naturally when you sell it, obviously realtor commission or whatnot. So obviously helps if you're a realtor and you're an investor as well. But yeah, you have to keep in mind all those costs associated with it, especially when you're analyzing the deal. And then you can now go to either line of credit, hard money lending, or however you wish to do it.
Hey, it's a good point what both Aaron and Isaac are making. Bethany, you actually were a part of something really cool yesterday. I mean, it just happened yesterday. You know, Bethany gave us a unique lead from a wholesaler. For those people out there who don't know what a wholesaler is, they're pretty much an individual, simple 101 terms, an individual who finds a property through a distressed seller, and they're able to pass that that property off to an investor who's willing to flip it or keep it as a rental property. So Bethany gave us a solid lead yesterday, and as a result, me and my team were going to take on that project as an investment. Now, my decision is like, are we going to use strict capital and buy outright cash? Or are we going to use it and try to figure out a way to get some lending from another institution? And that's where Aaron said, you know, it depends on your situation. Well, can we use our capital? The answer would be yes. But depending on what we're trying to do, say if we're trying to open up another office or we're stuck in two or three projects, then all of a sudden you may not want to be using all your reserves or your cash reserves. So you may want to hold off on that and try to acquire that property with very little money down and leverage someone else's money, other people's money. That's an important thing. So, you know, thank God to Bethany, she was able to get us that lead, and as a result, we saw it very quickly, acted on it very quickly, and then we're going to try to turn that product. We're still going to figure out what we're going to do with it as far as if we're going to use all of our capital or if we're going to use some lending on that. So it's a good point.
Bravo, Bethany.
Yeah, you're awesome. Yeah. Welcome to the team, Bethany.
Yeah.
Get some props to Bethany.
I also feel, not knowing too much in like real estate, but kind of having a background in finance and accounting, I don't think it's smart for people to use capital if their savings is only pretty much like what they have is like, let's say $10,000. Like, it's not wise to use all that. So maybe borrowing would be like the best for those type of people who don't have a big amount of capital in their hands. So
why do you guys think people get freaked out when you're talking about borrowing? And in this case, borrowing a large amount of money to try to acquire a big product, a home.
I mean, I think people get freaked out. Overall, I think it goes back to just educating yourself and being experienced as far as an investor. Understanding the cost, where Isaac talked about, you have to analyze every single cost. You have to be so meticulous to every standpoint of how much the tile is going to cost, how much flooring is going to cost, and paint and whatnot. But I think ultimately, when someone wants to get that big of a loan, they have no idea what to do. Maybe they're just starting out. You know, like we talked about, you have to have a $10,000 at least idiot-proof fund also, because you never know what's going to happen. And what if they don't have experience as a realtor, they don't have any comps, they think they can sell it for $200,000, $205,000, but maybe market value is at $185,000, $190,000. So ultimately, they might take a loss on that, and then what? And then their foot is out the door, no more investing for them, because they didn't understand budget, they didn't understand how to analyze a market. So ultimately, I think that's the biggest thing for newbies, and even experienced investors who don't even know about the market from out of town. But that's the biggest problem that I see in my experience.
Yeah, there's this misconception out there that if you borrow, it's a bad thing. And I don't know if it's a local thing, if it's a regional thing, if it's a parenting thing or a cultural thing, but that's probably the worst advice that I could give my realtors or investors that are starting out. A great way to acquire wealth is actually to get into debt, good debt.
Exactly.
Leverage. And it's you're leveraging someone else's money. I would always tell this in my classes, whenever you're using too much of your effort, you're gonna get to that destination point, but you're gonna get to that destination point sweating and using way too much energy. Well, if you're pushing a boulder up a mountain, what's gonna happen? You know, let's try to leverage it. Let's try to use a huge wooden plank to try to use less energy or get there quicker by some other format. In this case, leveraging someone else's money, a financial institution, an aunt or uncle who has some assets, someone out there that could help you get to that destination point a little bit quicker.
Well, I think that is the biggest misconception between good and bad debt. Really debt, I mean, or just debt in general. Common dichotomy is just good debt, bad debt. You can use debt to make yourself money, you can get in debt. I mean, look, like you buy a car, it's not an asset, ultimately. If you buy a house, you use that house as an asset, it's gonna provide you income and profit later on. So that's the definition of an asset. I mean, it goes back to simple accounting. And I even think, as basic as that is, a lot of people don't understand that. And if they, you know, they can get to that point and educate themselves, it'll be a lot easier as far as analyzing data and the market and whatnot.
All right, guys, now, who do you think is well suited to be successful when investing in real estate?
Just kidding.
What do you think?
All of us. I think in general, I think it could be anyone. It's just like Brandon saying, make sure you know the market, make sure where you're buying, your location and everything, what's going to go into the property, what money are you going to put into it, because if you obviously put way too much money into it, at the end of the day, you're not going to be able to get that money back because you overpriced, you overspent, and you know. So I think everyone has a chance to do it, it's just making sure that you actually know, brush up on your knowledge and just get down and dirty with the numbers, you know, before you actually go into the property and do everything that you got to do.
Yeah, I think anybody who's willing to put in the work, which includes research, like you said, you know what I'm saying, having a plan, understanding that they have to invest time. It's not, you know, a quick, easy thing. It takes a lot of time when you're flipping homes. So I think anybody who's willing to put in the work and the time and the research can.
So you're a mom, right? What would you do if you want to invest and you don't have time? You have mouths to feed and bills to pay.
Make sure I have a good team.
There you
make
go.
Sure
so
I have somebody around
that,
me.
Yeah.
I have a group around me. I have people who are knowledgeable. I have a good contractor that I have a good relationship with. Somebody. You have to have a team. You can't do it by yourself. So you have to have a team.
So you're only as good as your team. It's that's what it is.
Basically.
Learning how to analyze numbers and get a phenomenal team that you have, you know, your tile guy, you have a granite guy, whatever you're going to do, just make sure you have a team that you can trust, you can check up on, and be honest.
And that was my struggle, guys, being transparent. Originally, when I was investing and doing a lot of those flips, you want to get your hands dirty. You want to get involved. And it does help you with a basic knowledge base. But the difficulty that I found is that, fortunately, contractors were like a revolving door. Once you give them your first drop payment, a lot of them, they just wouldn't give you the same service. But then you would find that diamond in the rough, that contractor was just grade A material. There was rock stars. And those are hard to come by. Just like great realtors, just like great mechanics, great cooks. They're not everywhere. So you just gotta constantly go back and forth and redraw your game plan and figure out where you're gonna be, because a lot of these contractors sometimes will will try to make sure that they mess up mommy a little bit on
those. I've heard of horror stories, you know, where somebody hires a contractor, don't really know too much about them, and they take the money and never hear from them again.
And they're
they
not
do
licensed.
A botched job, or they're not licensed.
But you
can't
sue.
Yeah, exactly. So you have to research and you have to build a relationship. And I think once you find somebody that you know is honest and somebody you can work with and you can trust, you're good. You just have to build those relationships with people.
So what would you say if you were to build like just like an NBA team, you want to have your point guard, your shooting guard, your small forward, your power forward, your center. What would you say would be your starting five of what kind of team members you need to be a successful investor?
I mean, number one, realtor.
You need a realtor. Why
do you need a realtor? You gotta be able to break down the market.
But what if I'm good at design? What if I know how to market? I don't need a realtor.
I mean, like I said, you can be great at design, but if you can't even understand the basic market value of a home, then you're gonna over design, you're gonna go over budget, and then you're gonna sell and you're gonna take a loss.
Good point.
So
you need a realtor. What else?
Exactly.
That's contractor. I mean,
absolutely. Contractor. You need a great contractor.
You need obviously either you have a good mind for design or a good eye for design, right? You need a whole team, man. You need a contractor that knows, you know, a little bit of everything, and try to get someone licensed. I mean, I can't emphasize that enough, that try to get someone licensed, because it can buy people, but it has for me at least. And back to that, so like, my question to you again now is, did you ever get down and dirty and just demo and stuff like that, and is it worth it for you?
Your ultimate goal, unless you're just an addict on it, I mean, your ultimate goal is for you to put the least amount of energy in that project, unless you are a contractor, and as a result of that, you'd like to get involved in your own personal flip. I'm not a contractor, I'm an investor, I'm a broker, but early on, I did get involved in a lot of these projects, because you have to know. It's like asking a mechanic, hey, change the pistons on that car, or a bartender to make a Long Island iced tea, or whatever, they have to practice. So as a result of that, you have to make sure that you're not getting ripped off. That's for me the biggest reason.
That includes the pricing, right?
Absolutely, absolutely. Yeah. I remember when I was renovating this office, when I was getting it up and running, a couple of my staff members saw me completely demoing the tile, and they asked me, why are you demoing the tile? And I said, you know how much it costs to demo a tile in El Paso, what the labor cost is? And he's like, no. He's like, exactly. That's why you need to demo at least once or twice in your life, so that whenever you go to an investment project, you know that they're not overquoting you 75 cents or $1.50 more than what was necessary. So long story short, get involved just because you have to understand what pricing is. But if it's best, try to oversee the project instead of micromanage the project.
Unless you're super maybe tight in your budget at the end and you overpriced it or something.
Unless you're screwed and tattooed, man, you try to not get overly involved in it, or unless you just have a natural skill for it and you like doing that stuff.
How do you price your investment after putting your money?
That's why you have to have a realtor, somebody who's knowledgeable and knows the market, because a lot of times people will go in and buy a house, they see a rundown house, and they think, oh, I have, you know, a vision for it, and they fix it up, and then they want to flip it, and then it comes time to, oh, well, I put so much into it, so I'm going to put it at this amount. But then all the houses, you know, in the 1 mile radius of that house is nowhere near what you want for that house. So you have to know the market.
Why do people feel like if I put a dollar in, I have to get a dollar out though?
I think a lot of people, some people that I do know, a lot of people are greedy. They want to do the work and they want top dollar.
Investors greedy?
Which, no, sometimes, but everybody wants to get the biggest profit possible. I think it's safe to say you go in, you know, the bigger the profit, the better, but you can't be unreasonable. You can't have, you know, crazy expectations. You have to have common sense, because you can list it for that amount, but if nobody wants to buy it, then that's ultimately no profit whatsoever, and then you have to rent the home.
Yeah, and the scary thing that shouldn't happen to an investor on a long-term basis on all your products that you're trying to push out is having a house in the market, and then you're overzealous on your price point, definitely. Shooting for the fences here, and then for 2, 3, 4, 5 months later, you're dropping huge chunks off of your property, $5,000 price reduction, $10,000, and that shouldn't happen for an investor that analyzed everything correctly on the front end. If they bought correctly, rule number one in real estate, you make your money on the purchase, not on the sale. If you buy correctly, then you have wiggle room to make some mistakes along the way because you purchased correctly. And so there should be no reason why you're swinging for the fences on your price point whenever you're marketing it. And that's where someone like a great realtor that tells you, hey, this is where the buck ends here. This is where I feel comfortable selling it. I want my realtors to be comfortable enough to be able to walk away from an investor who's overzealous on the price point. Because what's going to happen? They're just going to be angry that you can't sell a product that's overpriced. We don't want that. Who wants that? Who wants to take on a listing that's overpriced at that point? We've all been there. It's going to happen. So you got to be able to tame your client's expectations and be realistic. For me, the thing is, when they say, well, you're the expert, I don't think anyone in El Paso, anyone across the country is an expert. The data is an expert. Data should tell your story. And if there's no data on the wall, then you should not be able to accept that price. You want to be able to tell your client, hey, I'll accept this price, but understand this is my comfort level because of what the data
says. I would rather have a client be upset about that and I have to break the news to them than to be upset with me that the house is not selling. Because the ultimate goal is to get the house sold. So if we're not getting the house sold,
The budget in shopping is, I know from my experiences, it's huge because you gotta learn how to budget, obviously, what costs what, and then when you shop with it, Lowe's, Home Depot, you gotta know what you're getting. You can stay there a long, long time, so it's really about the timing, budget, and learning how to shop. I mean, do you think, Rick, that a lot of the times where you say, okay, here's my car contractor, this is what you need to give me, do you trust that all the time?
No. Come on now.
So that's the thing. A lot of people.
That's like trusting a woman with your credit card, just saying, go forward, buddy. It's not going to happen, man. I mean, no way. Absolutely.
And sometimes.
I know, right?
Yes. Yes, right? So, I mean, would any of you guys trust a person with their credit card completely? I've done it before. That's just because I've done enough projects with that person. But
not initially, for sure.
No, initially you got to watch your team members. You gotta walk your team members saying, this is your shopping list, this is where your budget is. And believe it or not, I mean, unfortunately, my biggest weakness as an investor is that I like nice things. And so when I'm shopping, sometimes I'm like, man, that tile looks sexier, but it is gonna cost me $2,500 more, $3,000 more. Okay, I'll just push up the price. And then I'm telling myself, what am I doing, Rick? That's not the way you make money in investing. So you gotta also tame your own expectations.
Because obviously it depends on the location that you're flipping.
Absolutely.
Yeah, like you said, obviously there's like, the low grade budget and in the middle, and then you got your high end. So that's what some people I feel like don't understand either. They come in with nice marble flooring and everything, and the area doesn't call for marble flooring.
Great point. My basketball coach would say, Rick, you started with $1 million finish, and no, $1 million move, and you finish with a nickel finish. So it's a very simple thing. Like you're going in there doing this crazy expectation, but then you fall short. You're a dollar short. Have you guys been showing clients homes in El Paso where you know it's a flip, because I've already kind of trained you guys to have that eye for it, and then all of a sudden you walk through the kitchen, wow, it's a fabulous kitchen. And what happens after that? You guys are calling me saying, Rick, this house is what happened to the rest of the house? Should that ever happen, guys? Should a flip ever go to the point where it only looks 20 to 30% finished?
It shouldn't be considered a flip. Say what was renovated.
So what's a flip? So what's a flip in your opinion? Is it just a concept of making money? Is that just for a lot of investors that's it? Or is it the cons? For me, I like putting my stamp on that product.
Yeah.
So I like people to know that, hey, whenever we give the keys to that respective buyer or someone or a realtor to show these homes, I want them to say, wow, this is sexy. This is cool. They did a really good job on it. There's a lot of good realtors out there that are doing a great job flipping. There's a lot of investors that are doing a really good job flipping. There's also people that just do carpet and paint. And in my opinion, I'm sorry.
That's not a flip. My last question, guys. Okay, so what is a good profit margin that an investor should shoot for when looking for properties? What should be their end result as far as how much money they should?
Hopefully the biggest profit margin.
Give you the fattest profit that you possibly can take, but it's
depends
a,
on the area, of course, on the market.
I think it depends on your job. If your main job is not an investor, let's say you're making $1,000 a month in your normal job, right? And all of a sudden you fall upon a good opportunity to invest, and that investment is going to give you $15,000, and it's going to take you 5 to 6 months to sell it. Take it. Your job is normally give you $1,000 a month. You're going to make $15,000 in 6 months. Yeah, it's not going to be until 6 months. But the pros outweigh the cons.
That's more than what you would
need. Absolutely. But for me, I started realizing a lot of people started asking me, Rick, why did you stop investing so heavily in El Paso and then going to other markets? Well, then as a result for me, then I outweighed my pros and cons. If I'm going to have a flip and it's going to make me $6,000, $7,000, $8,000, $9,000 in 6 months, guys, if you're a realtor, just close 2-3 deals. Why are you going to be forcing your capital and breaking your head and stressing out about contractors, stressing out about the loan, stressing out about an appraiser? Why? I mean, $7,000, $10,000 is not worth 6-7 months of headaches when you could just go ahead and bust your rear and get 2-3-4 contracts as a realtor. So that, for me, is my opportunity cost.
So where would you say, like, where the margin is where you don't take it, or where the margin is where, like, you know what, let's do this?
For me, every realtor is different. That's an investor. Every investor is different in El Paso. But I know for me in El Paso, I just won't touch it if it's any less than, if it has less than a 2 in front of it, if it's less than 20,000, 25,000, I'm not going to touch it, because, once again, you just go ahead and try to push as much as you can on your realtor practice, your broker practice, and bring that amount in.
But you think it's also, back to that, so 20K would be your max, right? Your that's the max.
Things have to work out for me to be like, okay, this is what
I'm
doing.
So what if it's one where, you know, quick example, where there's 15K where you can sell it in probably 6 weeks and you know, like, this is hot, this is, I didn't put that much work into it, would you take that? Because that's now you're you know, extending now, it's not 3 months anymore, 4 months that you can sell it, now it's
right? That's a good question. It depends on where I'm at financially with another project or another thing that I'm doing or whatnot. Absolutely at that point. I mean, I just, you know, we talked about it a lot. Should it be completely just about the money? If it's not about the money, then what is it for? You know, let's get the elephant out of the room here. But I also tell people, some of my investors that were, they didn't analyze correctly, and then they reach out to me a little bit too late, and I get them maybe like 60% of the project or one or 70% into the project. I tell them, if you break even at this point because you started incorrectly, if you break even, you talked about it a lot, Brandon, it's the experience that's more valuable than the amount of money. Because I promise you, you doing the same mistake once or twice or three times, it's not going to happen in investing too long. You're going to analyze things differently, right?
Yeah.
So do you think, you know, that article that came out about El Paso being one of the top places to flip, you know, it goes with certain factors, certain variables, you know. Do you think this would be a great place to continue investing for your clients and investors? Would you say, hey, start pushing into other markets, or do you think we have something good going on in El Paso?
Well, as a newbie investor, it's a good place to start, just because the cost is so low compared to other markets.
That and labor costs.
Yeah,
so
exactly.
Those two things going
on. It's less expensive than other markets, but once you get your foot in the door, you gain experience. I mean, then you can move on to other markets. You know, start locally, think globally. That's what Hillary Clinton used to say that.
Absolutely.
And I think, you know, it resonates with everyone who wants to get started in that. So, but I think we see a lot of people that want to start with $200,000, $250,000 projects, make 25, 30K, you know, because we're so emotionally just attached to the outcome that they don't even know what to do. They think they have great design skills, awesome. But you don't know anything on how to analyze a property. If you don't have a realtor, I mean, where are you really going to start at? Just because you can design a home doesn't mean you're going to get to where you need to be as far as profitable. So.
And then continuing on his, I mean, I think we're like the buyer market that we're in. Hopefully you priced your house right, you made it look right, and hopefully since it's a buyer market, you get multiple offers. Hopefully, you know. So I think it's a good market to be in right now to invest.
Hey. You guys are hitting on really good points. I mean, one of the reasons why I moved back from New York City to El Paso is when I was there with my real estate mentor. He was like, Rick, you're going to get to your destination here in New York, but if you go back to El Paso, you're going to launch. And it makes sense. Like, I felt like I was, I'm speaking frankly, I almost felt like, man, to go from the mecca of real estate, which is New York City, to come back to El Paso where things were much slower. Yeah, it's home, it's where family is, but it's much slower than where I was living at. I just felt, what did I do wrong, honestly? But then he was so right in that regard, because the barriers of entry into investing in El Paso were drastically a lot easier than they were in New York City. What in New York City, every home, every even renovation project's in the millions.
Yeah.
Whereas here, you can pick up 2-4 projects, $50,000-$60,000, rock and roll, you turn it for 120, turn it for 130, and then you go on to the next one. And that's when I realized that he knew what he was talking about, even though he knew nothing about El Paso. So that's a cool thing. But if you do want to make some substantial money, you can do it in El Paso, but you're going to have to eliminate all the hats. You're talking about, you're going to have to get it from the distressed seller,
yeah.
from the horse's mouth, you're gonna have to go directly to them and figure out a way to creatively get a property for pennies on the dollar. That's kind of what we're here for as real estate experts, not even experts, but just people that are willing to live in the housing community and figure out a way to make them some money.
I think El Paso is a great market for a true investor who wants to build their portfolio as far as building rental homes, multifamily complexes. I mean, it's low, it's inexpensive, but at the same time, you're always going to have a tenant, no matter what. You go through a lot of problems, though, but at the same time, it's going to be much more rewarding as you continue to build your wealth and you don't just want to flip. I think El Paso is a great market to definitely do that.
You were number one on the list for a reason,
right? Absolutely.
You just got to know the specific areas where
yeah.
you can invest in, northeast, east, west, wherever. You just got to know those areas very well.
I honestly, I love El Paso because, you know, every part of El Paso has made me some pennies here along the way, right? You just got to buy correctly. Northeast has been one of my favorite spots to invest. I mean, to develop a rental portfolio there has been something that has really allowed me to go to a different area of investing. I don't think there's any one specific area here in El Paso that I wouldn't invest in. If you buy correctly, you know, granted the newer subdivisions, I always find investors, they say, I want to buy this property that's built in 2011. I'm like, where are you gonna make money? that home's pretty close to being brand new, unless the original loan was so low. Get your hands dirty on an older project. That's the fun part.
All right, guys, this wraps up our MRG open corner out here. We would love to hear through either email or direct message through Instagram. Let us know. Thanks, guys.
See you at the top. Give us a like on Facebook.